All right, good afternoon. I want to welcome you to the next in our series of webinars presented by CUES. This will be our last one for 2022. My name is Craig Leckler. I'm the marketing manager at CUES, and I'll be your host for today. For today's topic, well, we haven't had enough of them yet, so we're bringing back Eric Sebring for one more time to discuss our remote diagnostic tool, the CUES REDI Kit. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce our speaker for today's presentation, Mr. Eric Sebring. Eric, take it away.
Thank you for attending today. Give you a little bit of background on who I am. Been with the company for almost 27 years now. I was the lead technician in electronic repair for 9 years. Did troubleshooting phone support for 12 years. I've been doing the technical schools for a little over 5 years now. In the past, I've worked directly with CAD on developing maintenance and repair procedures for the grout pumps, and I'm actually the person who came up with the idea and designed most of the REDI kit. So I think I'm a pretty decent person to talk about what it does and how it works. Okay. In this presentation, we're going to be going over the REDI kit and hooking it up with the K2 and what it should actually be doing and how you should use it. Okay. So in this presentation, I'll be going over the parts that are in the REDI kit with you. I'll be showing you how to connect them, what they do, and how to use each part. Along with the REDI kit, I'll be going over some of the different diagnostics that are built into the K2 system. Combining the REDI kit with the K2 diagnostic screens will aid you in locating issues that might arise on your system. First, we're going to take a look at the parts that are included in the REDI kit. Then we'll get into how to hook them up and what they do. There are 5 major parts to the REDI kit. Along with these parts, there are a few other things in the kit that'll help aid in troubleshooting. They are just spare cables and adapters that you can use to bypass things and jumper around things. Okay, the first major component that's in the REDI kit is going to be the breakout box with an internal camera built into it. The next is a footage encoder box to help you troubleshoot footage issues. Next, we have a digital voltmeter, a USB voltmeter, and a USB webcam. Okay, REDI kit. The breakout box with the internal camera. This unit was designed to be used either with or without your camera and transporter attached. To connect this unit, make sure that you're at your configuration screen or the K2 is turned off. On the face of the breakout box, you will see camera on one side and truck on the other. The camera will plug into your camera and transporter. The truck will plug into your main TV cable coming off the reel. Once this is completed, you can power the K2 back up as normal. And here, the first picture you see, I have where it says camera, it's plugged into my transporter. And on the other side where it says truck, I've got it plugged into my TV cable coming off of the reel. On the top of the box, you have 12 test points labeled 1 through 12. These test points correspond to the pins on the end of your TV cable. So pin 1 on this box is pin 1 on the end of the TV cable. Pin 2 on the box is pin 2. If you take a look at the cable end drawing that you use to terminate your cable, you will see that the pigtail side is labeled with pins 1 through 12 on the left-hand side. The drawing also gives you what each pin does. So if you look at pin 1, it says video shield. Pin 2 is video coax. So you can find camera power on pin number 5, which is camera plus, and pin number 6, which is camera negative. And check it out on the breakout box. So now that we know that the test points on the breakout box correspond with the pins on the pigtail, we can use this to check the video path on pins 1 and 2, or take voltages for camera, lights, left and right motors. Again, this can be done with your camera and transporter hooked up, which we recommend, because you're putting a load on the system with your camera and transporter, or with no equipment on the output of the breakout box at all. The breakout box also has a switch on the top side that allows you to switch between your camera and an internal camera to verify that your camera is working. This is helpful if you don't have a second camera on the truck to be able to have a video source that you can use to check with. In other words, in a no video condition, the breakout box gives you the option of having that extra camera there to allow you a second video source just to verify your camera is working correctly. To use this feature, make sure that your K2 is powered up and that you have the correct camera selected in your configuration screen. Once this is done, you can just select the test position on the switch and it will switch to the internal camera. It is recommended that if you don't have video on your main camera, hook up your test cable before you do this. Cable issues can damage camera modules. If you have video on the internal camera, but not on your main camera, then the issue will be inside of your main camera. The breakout box also has a video out on the bottom side of the unit. It says external video out. This external video out is using the same video feed that is being sent to your K2. If you have the video switch on main, then it'll send the main video to the external video out. This port is to allow you for testing of lateral reels or monitors. By hooking up a cable to the BNC port and then connecting the other end of the cable or monitor, you can send the main video or the test video out of the box by pushing and holding the red button. Once you release the button, it will send the video back down the main cable to your K2. So in other words, to get video out of there, you have to continue to hold that red button. Having the ability to inject video into a system in different points to verify the video path is another way to help isolate issues. The footage box. This box is designed to help narrow down when you have a problem with footage on the main reel. It is simple to connect and use. To connect it, power down the K2, then disconnect your footage cable from the encoder on the footage head. The box will accommodate both older and newer style encoder cables. Choose the connector on the footage box that matches the one you have on your truck. Screw in the footage cable to the test box and power the K2 back up. The footage box has a built-in encoder and test points to test the 5 volts DC that powers up the encoder. Once you have the footage box connected and powered up, you can use the voltmeter to check the 5 volts DC on the front of the unit. You can also rotate the knob labeled footage to see if the footage will change on the screen. If it does, you've got a bad encoder. If it doesn't, you more than likely have a bad cable going to your encoder. The digital voltmeter that is located in the REDI kit is a perfect small meter for use in the TV trucks. This meter, although it's small, does everything an operator will need it to do to aid in diagnosing their truck. There's really only 3 things that will ever need to be used on this or any other meter. Volts AC, used for checking generator or house power to verify that you have 120 volts AC. Volts DC is used for testing camera power, light power, and motor powers. Ohms, used to do resistance check on cables and the video path. USB digital meter. This meter was included to allow for checking the 5 volt DC power supply inside of the K2. This voltage is very critical in getting the motherboard to start up inside of the K2's CCU. By attaching the USB digital meter to one of the USB ports on the K2 CCU, we can verify that the voltage is where it should be. The meter is not as accurate as opening the unit up and connecting the meter directly to the power supply. In this case of using the USB ports on the front or the back of the CCU, you are measuring that voltage after it passes through an internal USB hub. If you use the direct port on the back of the K2 CCU, this also has to pass through the motherboard inside of the CCU. Although it does give us a very good indication of what the power supply is doing. In the previous picture, it showed that the voltage was 5.11 volts DC. This is very close to what the power supply was set to at 5.19 volts DC. So it's not dead on accurate, but it's close enough for what we need to see if we're getting the 5 volts from the power supply to power the motherboard up. USB webcam. There's an old saying that a picture speaks 1,000 words. When dealing with the amount of equipment inside of a standard TV truck, this is very true. Having the ability to see what the operator is seeing on a truck helps the people at CUES to better understand what is going on. The webcam is one way of doing this. It can be hooked directly into your CUES computer. If you're in an area that has Wi-Fi, we can connect to the web camera via Zoom meeting and view what is actually going on inside of the truck or with the video. The web camera has a 15-foot cable attached to it. Plus, there's an additional 15-foot extension in the bottom of the REDI kit that will allow you to go anywhere inside of the truck. Nowadays, most customers have smartphones that will allow them to do the same feature. The web camera we provided has a very clear video feed and can be put within a few inches of an object and still be in focus. This also allows for you to still be able to talk on your cell phone to a representative from CUES without having to move the camera all the time. Cables. The last thing we've included in the REDI kit is some additional cables and adapters. Inside the bottom of the kit, you'll find the USB meter, a few adapters, and some extra cables, RCA to RCA, and a USB extension cable. Now, the adapters that are in there are able to plug into a RCA cable to switch it over to a BNC. So if you need an RCA to BNC cable or a BNC to BNC, the adapters will make that RCA cable do that. Okay, these are in the kit to be able to bypass things if they are suspected to be defective, whether it's a bad cable that you need to verify as being defective or a defective piece of equipment that you want to bypass around. So far, we have shown you what's in the REDI kit and how to hook it up. Before we get into how to use it, we'll need to go over K2 diagnostics a little bit first. The K2 has some great diagnostic programs built into the system to help you if an issue should arise. Here are a few different diagnostic screens and how to get to them. From a live video screen, start by pressing Escape on the K2 keyboard to enter the main menu. Once you get to the main menu, go down to Run Diagnostics and press Enter. This key will take you to the next menu. Here we see three different options. Test cable continuity, use for testing the cable on your reel. Note this will check lights, camera, and both motor wires for continuity. It does not test the video wires. Test handheld controller functionality, use to verify the buttons on your handheld controller. Note, test the wireless controller, the wired controller cannot be plugged into the K2. And the third one is display power supply status. Shows what the K2 CCU and PCU power supplies are doing. Test cable continuity. The screen is used in conjunction with the blue loopback plug. Do not use this plug on the test cable. It is only designed for your TV cable. Most people have no clue what that little blue plug is. It's in their toolbox, but that is actually your loop plug. And when we designed the REDI kit, we actually designed a little hole for it to go in so that it doesn't get lost. Okay, the loopback plug gets connected at the end of your TV cable where your transporter and camera normally are plugged in. The screen will take you through a series of steps to do this test. Follow the steps, and once you've completed what is asked, then press Enter after each step. After you've clicked the Enter key on Apply Power and Begin Test, it will display a series of numbers based on the type of cable you have selected in the configuration screen. When you look at the footage length of each line, camera, lights, left motor, and right motor, they should all be close to each other in footage value. If they are not close, more than 50 feet of each other, then there's an issue in the TV cable or a connection. And I see this quite often where just a bad connection can cause these numbers to be off. I mean, if they're way off 400 or 500 feet, then there's definitely an issue with the cable. But if it's off 50, 60, 70, 80 feet, a lot of times just cleaning connectors can correct this. The next thing that the screen will show you is the mean cable length. This is a very good estimate of how much cable is left on your truck at the time of the test. Now, this is assuming that the test did okay, you didn't have an opener or a short someplace, that all the values were within 50 feet of each other, then this mean cable length is pretty close to what you actually have left on the truck. Once you finish the test, it will ask you to remove the loopback plug and end test. Once this is done, it'll take you back to the configuration screen. Test handheld controller functionality. This screen allows you to press buttons on the controller, and the screen will show what button is being pushed. If you're having an issue with your system, it's a good place to start with. By testing the controller, you have ruled out the possibility of just having a stuck or bad button that can cause issues. Again, make sure that if you're trying to test your wireless controller, that the wired controller is not plugged in and the batteries in the wireless controller are good. One thing that I see quite often is the mode button on the controllers gets pressed. And then all it does is it swaps your left D-pad with your left joystick. So people will call in saying that they can't get their lights to turn on, and the mode button will be on, so it's swapped those two, so they're no longer, your lights button is no longer working the way it should. So if you're having an issue, always start with that screen just to make sure that it's not something going on with the controller. Display power supply status. This screen has a lot of information on it as to what's going on with your system. The main things to look at are camera power, light power, left motor, and right motor. Along with these rows, each one has four columns that go along with them. Set point voltage, source current, and load voltage. The first three columns are the ones that are actually measured. The load voltage is calculated value based on the cable length and the current load on that circuit. This column is going to be the closest one to what a meter will read at the end of the cable when connected to the breakout box. You'll see this when we go over the breakout box that is in the REDI kit. Set point voltage. This is the voltage that the CCU is asking the PCU to output. So in the case of the camera, the CCU is asking the PCU to output 40 volts DC. Lights is asking for 82 volts DC, and the motors are at 0 volts DC. Source voltage is what the PCU is actually outputting to the cable. So when we look at the source, we can see that it's not exactly the same as the set point, but it should be very close. If your set point for your camera is 40 volts and your source is 0 or 10 volts or 12 volts, that means you've got an issue someplace. And more than likely, you have a short in the camera or a short in your TV cable causing that. The next column is going to be source current. This is the actual current that each one is using. We see that the camera is showing a current draw of 0.133 amps, and the lights are showing 0.0 amps. This is because currently the camera is powered up, but the lights are not turned on. So we send the light voltage down to the camera and it's there all the time, but we actually have to physically turn it on with the controller to get the lights to come on. Once you turn the lights on, then your current will go up. Depending on whether you have LEDs or incandescent, it'll go up. I think LEDs run about 0.2 amps and incandescent run about 0.8 or 0.9 amps. The last column is the load voltage. This column is only used when you have a breakout box connected. When using the REDI kit, this last column should be very close to what you would read using your digital voltmeter on the test point on the breakout box at the end of the cable. So we've now covered some of the diagnostic tools that are built into the K2, and we have went over what is in the REDI kit. It's time to hook both of them up and see what they can do. I will go over what you should expect to see and get into a little about what could cause these readings not to be correct. So the first thing we want to do is to connect our REDI kit to the end of the TV cable. Start by going to the configuration screen or turning the power switch off on the front of the K2 CCU. Once connected, you can power the unit back up and verify configuration screen is correct. The inspection system is made up of five major parts: camera power, light power, right motor, left motor, and video. We went over how the loopback plug can test the TV cable for camera, lights, left motor, and right motor, but it doesn't check the video. So in this next slide, I'm going to use the breakout box and the digital voltmeter to check my video path. And I'll explain how I came up with the number when I'm done checking it. At the configuration screen, turn the meter on and select ohms. Insert one meter lead into pin number one and the other into pin number two. Polarity doesn't matter in ohms, so it doesn't matter which color you put in there. The meter reads 104 ohms. This is a good reading for the amount of cable that is connected. And the reason for this, all video is terminated with a 75 ohm resistor, and the video path is about 32 ohms per 1,000 feet of gold cable. I have 900 feet of gold cable connected, so if I take 32 per 1,000 and divide it up into 900, I come out with 28.8 ohms. Plus my 75 ohm resistor gives me 103.8 ohms. So 104 is a good reading. On 1,000 foot, I normally expect to see about 107 there with all the connections and everything, 108. So anything in that range is considered to be good. The path that the meter was looking at is the coax of the TV cable to the slip ring in the center of the reel. From the slip ring, it goes through an umbilical cable to the system select box. From there, it goes to the terminal strip and then to the back of the PCU. Comes out of the PCU through another umbilical cable to the CCU. The 75 ohm resistor is located inside of the CCU. All of the voltage for camera, lights, and motors follow this basic path. Difference is the voltages will start in the PCU and they go to the end of the cable. Video starts in the camera and goes backwards from the voltages. Light power can be measured on the breakout box on pin 3 for positive and pin 4 for negative. You refer to your cable end drawing for pin locations and functions. In the picture, you will see that I have my red lead in pin number 3 and my black lead in pin number 4. The meter is reading my light voltage at 81.6 volts DC. With the meter reading of 81.6 volts DC, we can compare this to our display power supply status screen. We can see that the light source voltage is 81.9 on this screen. The meter and the screen are reading almost the same voltage, telling us it should be a good value. If you're within a volt of whatever these are saying, then it's usually a good reading. When you're off a lot, whether it's 30 or 40 volts or whatever, then you start looking at the cable. And the first thing to do is always hook up your test cable and try it again. Camera power can be found on the breakout box on pin number 5 for positive and pin number 6 for negative. Again, refer to your cable end drawing and it'll show you which two pins it is. But all of our cables are exactly the same for these. Inserting the red lead into pin number 5 and the black lead into pin number 6. Here it shows camera power is reading 37.8 volts. When we compare to our display power supply screen, we can see that our source voltage for the camera is 39.6. This is a little higher than what the meter reads due to the fact the camera is powered up and putting a load on the circuit. In the case of the lights were not on, so it was no load. So it was a lot closer to the source voltage. And when we get to the last screen where it shows the load, you'll actually see that for our camera, it'll be a lot closer to what the meter read. Our motors don't really have a positive and negative. When going forward, the left motor will read positive and the right motor will read negative voltage. To go backwards with the transporter, these voltages will reverse. So the left motor will now read negative and the right motor will now read positive. As I go through the next steps, I will give you the correct pin numbers to show in forward. left motor being positive, right motor being negative. When running a non-steerable transporter, like the Ultra Shorty or a WTR, the left motor is the only one that is used. Starting with the left motor, red lead from the meter will be connected to pin number 7, and the black lead will be connected to pin number 9. Note that the voltage is still 0. This is because we are not telling the K2 to drive the transporter forward. Once we push the joystick forward or backwards on the controller, the meter should then read the voltage that the PCU is putting out. Looking at the display power supply screen shows the same thing. Both the left and right motors are still at 0 volts DC. Now press the joystick forward. You should see the voltages going up based on how much you push the joystick forward. Remember, in this setup, the left motor should be reading a positive value as we are going forward. The meter at full speed is reading 138.6 volts DC. The display power supply screen shows that our left motor in this state should be 140, but our calculated load voltage is closer to what the meter reads at 138.9 volts DC. So going forward gives us a positive voltage on the left motor, then going backwards gives us a negative voltage. Now the meter is actually reading -136.5, and if we look at the left motor for our load voltage, it's reading 136.8. Both almost identical. The right motor works the same as the left motor. The difference is that when going forward, we see a negative voltage going to the right motor. When the meter is reading -138.6 here, and our load voltage is reading 138.9. When going backwards, the right motor will show a positive voltage, and the left will show a negative voltage. So here we're checking 11 and 12, which is our right motor. And we have 136.9 on the meter, and our load voltage is saying 137.1, but 0.2 volts off, which is acceptable. Using the breakout box to do continuity tests on your system, most of us have had to check wiring for opens or shorts in the past. With the breakout box, it makes it a lot easier to do this. I know I have fought with trying to hold a meter lead on a pin at the end of the cable and trying to take the other meter lead and put it on a pin on a connector to read if I have continuity. Using the breakout box and your system drawing, you can put one of the meter leads in a pin on the breakout box and follow it all the way through your truck. Here I'm tracing the shield of the coax. So I have my meter on ohms and I have my red lead in pin number 1 all the way to the terminal strip. This can be done with any of the wires in the system. So on the terminal strip, I know it's pin number 9 because my drawing shows it on pin number 9, and my meter is reading about 5.09 ohms. So I'm just reading the shield from one end of the cable all the way up to where my terminal strip is. What we just went through is for a standard TV truck with a steerable transporter and camera. If your truck is equipped with other equipment, such as a cutter, then the breakout box can also be used to verify the voltages for the cutter motors. Refer to your cable imprint for the pin numbers that correspond to the motor you want to test. Just as we tested the motors for the transporter, you will connect your meter to the appropriate pins on the breakout box for the motor that you want to test, and then activate the motor on the controller to read the voltage. I hope after watching this webinar, you have a better understanding of how the K2 diagnostics, along with the REDI Kit, can help with diagnosing your system if an issue should arise. This unit was designed to help you as the operator to be able to locate issues easier and more effectively. Thank you for watching.
All right, Eric, thank you so much. Great presentation.
Thank you.
So that does wrap up our webinar. We want to thank you all for attending today and hope you found value in our presentation. If you have any further questions or would like to talk to someone from CUES regarding our REDI Kit, please feel free to reach out directly to Eric. His contact details are on your screen. You can also always visit the CUES website for more information.
Also, the hardware troubleshooters know how to use the REDI Kit. So if you're using it and need some help, you can always contact any of the troubleshooters at CUES, and they can also help you with it.
Perfect. Thank you, Eric.
You're welcome.
Once again, thank you all for attending.